recording?
Yeah, I've been recording.
Wow.
How you doing? Okay, ready?
Quarantine life. Gotta get back to my quarantine life.
Oh, how I don't want to get back to my quarantine life. I want to see my High Point family. Can't wait to come and worship with you again.
Hi, High Point.
We're the Albers. We really miss you guys, and we're excited to see you again soon.
Hello, High Point family.
Hello, High Point. How you doing?
Hi, guys. How are ya?
We sure do miss you. We miss our church family so much. We wish you could just come down here to Door, Michigan. We'd have church right in our backyard.
That's right. Come on out. When this is all over.
As we gather today in our own homes, just remember that the people are the church, not the church building. When you go out, as often as that may be, make sure that you're the hands and feet of Jesus.
We love you all. We miss you very much.
We wish we could all be together again. We sure do miss our church family.
Can't wait to see you again.
Miss you guys. See you soon.
Bye, guys.
See ya.
Sia.
Sia.
Get your toilet paper. Bring it along. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I did not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. Christ Savior's love through the storm. He is Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor
in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see His wounds, His hands, His feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid Him down in Joseph's tomb. The ancient seal by heavy stone, Messiah.
Oh, Lord. What to do when we don't know what to do? It's a question we're all asking right now in this COVID-19 lockdown. How do I live? How do I function now in a society that's been sort of turned upside down? How do I navigate? The other day I was at the gas station and I was putting my credit card in, and I'm put the credit card in and I'm punching the numbers for my zip code, and I'm asking the question, who else just pushed these buttons? And I'm taking the handle and putting gas in. I'm asking, who else just touched this handle? It's questions I'm asking now that I wasn't asking maybe a few months ago. I'm not a germaphobe. I try to stay as clean as I possibly can, but we're asking new questions now. When I'm raising my kids, I'm asking the question, like, how do I lead them well in this environment? How do I not go crazy in this environment? How do I help them not go crazy? But also, how do I help them love their family well and love God well and pursue God with all their heart? How do I lead them well when I'm not even sure how I'm supposed to live? We need wisdom. And praise God that God has granted us the promise of granting us wisdom. Wisdom is exactly what we need to understand how to live, how to navigate, how to make the right decision. What step do I take next? In James 1, verse 5, it says, if anyone lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously without reproach, and he will grant him wisdom. It's a promise. I remember as a young kid clinging to this promise. I remember when I was 15 years old, my dad had died when I was 10, and I was trying to figure out, okay, how do I become a man? Like, what does that mean? And I had two older sisters and a mom, and there was another guy around me, and I'm trying to think, like, what does it mean to be a man? What does that mean? And asking God from his word to show me. And looking at the passage in regard to Solomon's life, who had asked God for wisdom, and I thought, you know, I want that. I want wisdom in my own life. How do I make the right decisions? How do I make the right calls on things? It's a question that we're all asking right now. How do I live? How do I make the right call? How do I know what's right and what's wrong, what I should do and what I shouldn't do? I want to encourage you to turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 1. It's the story of Solomon's life. Now, Solomon is the, just to set the stage, Solomon is the great-great-grandfather of the king that we looked at last week, Jehoshaphat. And Solomon is at the scene that we're going to look at, is 20 years old. He's 20 years old. Now, I remember when I was 20 years old and I didn't know what I was doing. And I didn't know at that time I would have been probably a junior in college. And I had changed my major and I was just asking the question, like, who am I going to be and how's God leading me? And when you're 20, you don't know a lot. And if you're much older than that now, looking back on when you were 20, you're like, yeah, I didn't know anything when I was 20. If you're 20 right now and you're thinking, oh, yeah, what do I know? And you get this whole deal, or maybe you're 10 and you're watching this and you're like, when I'm 20, I'll know everything. Well, trust me, you won't. none of us really, really do when we're 20. And here's Solomon, who has just now inherited the kingdom from his dad, King David, the man after God's own heart, the one who everyone acclaims, the hero of Israel, right? He's the man, like everyone acclaims him, and I do to this day, and as you should, like he is the man. He is the one who pursued God. Now, he had situations where he sinned and turned his back on God for a period of time, but he always fell on his face, and he always repented. He always said, you know what? I don't want that path. I want the path that you would have for me, God. He's a man after God's own heart. He conquered Goliath. He conquered the Philistines. He took the throne from Saul. God had given it to him. He was best friends with Saul's son, Jonathan, and has songs written about him from his battles. I mean, this is your dad. He's the man. And you never want to follow the man in leadership. It's always the hardest thing in leadership to follow the man. You want to blaze your own trail, right? And yet here's Solomon, 20 years old. Has to talk to thousands of generals, all older than him, of course, and all of whom had deferred to David and his leadership. And now here's this young punk, 20 years old, who's now leading all of Israel, the unified kingdom in Jerusalem, the Jerusalem that David had conquered and taken from the Philistines, right? It's a unique situation. here is our scene. We get to the scene in 2 Chronicles chapter 1 and find Solomon taking the throne and hearing the words that God had blessed him. 2 Chronicles 1, starting in verse 1. Solomon, the son of David, established himself in his kingdom, and the Lord his God was with him and made him exceedingly great. Solomon spoke to all Israel, to the commanders of thousands and to hundreds, and to the judges and to all the leaders in all of Israel, the heads of fathers' houses. Do you get the stress here? Do you get the sense of like he's commanding a large multitude, diverse people, all leaders in their positions, and he's commanding them now as a 20-year-old. And look what he does. And Solomon, verse 3, and all the assembly with him went to the high place that was at Gibeon, for the tent of meeting of God, which Moses, the servant of the Lord, had made in the wilderness, was there. The tent of meeting is the tabernacle where the Ark of the Covenant was. And it says here in verse 4, but David had brought up the Ark of God from Kiriath-Jearim to the place that David had prepared for it, for he had pitched a tent for it in Jerusalem. The Ark of the Covenant is here, the Ark of God, in the tent of meeting. And in Hebrew, the tabernacle, the meaning of the Hebrew is rest and to dwell. And the idea is this is where God is dwelling with his people. And here's Solomon who goes to the high place at Gibeon. And Gibeon, you can see on a map, is north of Jerusalem. And it's where Solomon lived before he goes into Jerusalem to take over leadership. But he's there at the high place. And he's there seeking God, where the tabernacle is, where God dwells with his people. There's also something else that's important about Gibeon. And years prior, there's great rich history from Joshua's day. And remember, Joshua had taken over for Moses. Same deal. Like, Moses is a hero. And then here's Joshua taking over for Moses, this great leader who had led the children of Israel out of slavery in Egypt and now is just on the cusp of entering into Israel. And they're on the east side of the Jordan. They cross over. The route of the Exodus was through the modern country of Jordan, now across the Jordan River into Israel. And it's Joshua that leads them. And if you remember the story, you know, he had conquered Jericho, and he was a great leader and a great military leader. And then we get to Gibeon, and this is in Joshua chapter 10. If you look back to Joshua 10, you can see what happened at Gibeon, where the people of Gibeon had tricked Joshua. So it's full of the Gibeonites, which are descendants of Ham from Noah, kinfolk. But God says this is going to be the descendants of, in this case, David's lineage. And so you get to chapter 9, and it says that Joshua was tricked by the Gibeonites, and there was a battle between them, but they pretended they were someone from far off and tricked Joshua into a covenant of saying sort of a truce that you won't attack us, right? And so he didn't. And so then, because other kings from the area had heard that Joshua had formed a truce and had heard what Joshua had done from other areas, well, they got threatened. And so they come and they attack. And so on this day of battle, you see verse 6 of Joshua 10, it says, and the men of Gibeon sent to Joshua at the camp of Gilgal, saying, do not relax your hand from your servants. Come up to us quickly and save us and help us. For all the kings of the Amorites who dwell in the hill country are gathered against us. And so Joshua went up from Gilgal, he and all the people of war with him, and all the mighty men of valor. And the Lord said to Joshua, do not fear them, for I have given them into your hands. Not a man of them shall stand before you. And that theme of faith versus fear is prevalent throughout the Old Testament, prevalent in our story that we're looking at. Like, don't fear them. I'll be with you. As we saw last week with Jehoshaphat, The battle is mine, says God. And Joshua, verse 9, came upon them suddenly, having marched up all night from Gilgal. And the Lord threw them into a panic before Israel, who struck them with a great blow at Gibeon and chased them by the way the ascent of Beth Horon and struck them as far as Azekah and Makeda. And as they fled before Israel, while they were going down the ascent of Beth Horon, the Lord threw down large stones from heaven on them as far as Azekah, and they died. There were more who died because of the hailstones than the sons of Israel killed with a sword. And here, verse 12, at the time Joshua spoke to the Lord in that day, the Lord gave the Amorites over to the sons of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, sun, stand still at Gibeon. The moon in the valley of Ajalon, and the sun stood still, and the moon stopped, and the nation took vengeance on their enemies. And then it goes on saying that since that day, the sun has not stood still. The sun stood still at Gilgal, at Gibeon, where Joshua had conquered all those kings in that day to protect that land. And so Gibeon became this place of notoriety where God had been there and God had saved them. And Solomon, in his wisdom, he goes to Gibeon, the high place where Joshua had seen God deliver the children of Israel. And the sun stood still. This is a place where God was. And Solomon goes and pursues God. And the path of wisdom, the first path we see Solomon take is to look up. It's to look up at his God and to look up and defer, knowing where his help comes from. And he goes to that high place in Gibeon. He says, I'm deferring to ancient stories that happened here where the sun stood still and that God delivered the children of Israel. And I'm going to that high place now to seek wisdom from God because I'm 20 years old and I don't know what to do and where to turn. He looks to the source of all the goodness that had come his way. He looks to the source, to God. He looks up. He says, I'm deferring to the one who I know my help will come from. And we know the great psalm from Psalm 121 that I know I've been quoting lately and just deferring to on a number of occasions. And if you don't know that psalm, you should get to know that psalm. In fact, before you go into work each day, you should repeat that psalm. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will not slumber nor sleep. The Lord is my keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord. It does not slumber and does not sleep. That's what Solomon knew. He goes to the high place at Gibeon and pursues God where the ark is, Ark of the Covenant, the tent of meeting where God had met with the children of Israel through Moses and now into Solomon's day. It's a history that Solomon leans into. He looks up. He looks to the one from whom he knows he will be given wisdom to lead his life. He looks up. Carrying on in the passage, we see what else he does. Not only looks up, he looks within. Carrying on in verse 7, it says, In that night, God appeared to Solomon and said to him, ask what I shall give you. And Solomon said to God, you have shown great and steadfast love to David, my father, and have made me king in his place. And you sense some stress right there, right? Like, I mean, thank you, God, but like, I'm now leading and I need your help. And so verse 9, O Lord God, let your word to David, my father, be now fulfilled. For you have made me king over people as numerous as the dust of the earth. Give me now wisdom and knowledge to go out and come in before this people. For who can govern this people of yours, which is so great? You hear the opportunity, you hear the perspective that Solomon has, and he says, give me wisdom. Look within me and see where I lack it, and fill me with that wisdom. Help me to know what steps to take and not to take, and what to do and what not to do, and what to say and what not to say, and how to lead. How do I do this? I need your help, God. He asks God to look within him. It's the question that I hope all of us are asking in this path to acquire wisdom is looking within our lives. What's in our hearts? And the real fear I have with this season, and as people are more isolated, increasingly isolated, are we listening to voices that are not true? Are we listening to words that are not life-giving? I'm afraid that people will turn more to alcohol, and alcoholism will go on the rise, and we'll see a lot of problems stemming from this whole lockdown. I'm fearful for people in that sense, that I think there are gaps in our life, or cracks maybe, that will be revealed in wider ways, and the whole path of isolation that gets us alone and makes us afraid, it's not a good environment. And God, through Solomon's life, gives us a snapshot, a picture of what it means to seek God in this season and say, God, I need wisdom, how to live and how to act. And if you are in that state where you're like, you feel more isolated, you feel more alone, like, what is the path? Like, how do I navigate? We're given a clue into Solomon's life where he asks God, he says, God, I need you. Please give me wisdom that you gave to David. I need that same wisdom. Another clue we'll get from even James, on the heels of James 1:5, where he gives us another clue. He says, not only, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without a reproach, and it will be given him. But then the next verse says, but let him ask in faith, with no doubting. For the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. For the person does not suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He's double-minded, unstable in all his ways. Faith. God, grant me faith. I need faith. I need faith to pursue you, God. Faith knowing that if I ask for wisdom, that you'll grant me wisdom and how to live and how to act and what to do and what not to do. Grant me wisdom. In fact, there's another promise about faith from Hebrews chapter 11. And Hebrews is right before James. And so if you're in James, you can flip back a little bit. We know that faith, the definition of faith is given in verse 1. It says, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, and the conviction of things not seen. And then it continues on, for by it people of old received their commendation. By faith we understand the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. And it goes on, by faith Abel offered a sacrifice to God more acceptable than Cain. And continuing down a bit, in verse 6, it says, and without faith it's impossible to please him, meaning God. It's impossible to please God. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. Solomon knew the deeper secret. Solomon knew the deeper truth of God's teachings and God's ways. That God rewards those who seek him. That God rewards those who pursue him and say, God, I want to have a heart of wisdom. I want to have a heart dedicated to you. I want to know what's right and what's not right. I want your heart to be my heart, in essence. And that God rewards those who seek him. And Solomon's no dummy. He knows exactly what he needs. And he needs God to lead him in all of his ways. He says to him, not only look within me, but I'm going to look up to you, God, because I know you're my source. He looks up, he looks within, and the final thing in the passage, he looks around. 2 Chronicles 1, continuing on in the story, it says, verse 11, God answered Solomon, because this was in your heart, You've not asked for possessions and wealth and honor or the life of those who hate you. You've not even asked for long life, but you asked for wisdom and knowledge for yourself, that you may govern my people over whom I've made you king. Wisdom and knowledge are granted to you. But I'll also give you riches and possessions and honor, such as none of the kings who were before you and none after you shall have the like. And so Solomon came from the high place at Gibeon, from before the tent of meeting, to Jerusalem, and he reigned over Israel. And it says, verse 14, Solomon gathered together chariots and horsemen. He had 1,400 chariots, 12,000 horsemen, whom he stationed in the chariot cities and with the king in Jerusalem. And the king made silver and gold as common in Jerusalem as stone. And he made cedar as plentiful as the sycamore of the Shephelah. Here you see God blessing Solomon. Here you see God blessing him abundantly. But not because he said to God, I want to be rich, and I want to be wealthy, and I want to have honor and long life and the head of my enemy. He doesn't say all that. He says, I just want to have wisdom. I just want to know what's right. I want to know what to do and what not to do. I want that. And God grants him that. In fact, he blesses him abundantly in a lot of other areas and makes him a king that he blesses more than those before him and those after him, because he asked the right thing. In our season of life, when I see us on lockdown, I see so many people looking around for ways they can help. And that's incredible. And that's going to be a path where we can come out of this in a far healthier way. When we're asking the question, how can I match my faith to my actions? It's the story of the rest of James when he says, if you see someone in need, meet that need. And if you don't, what good is your faith? Your faith is lived out in action. Wisdom is lived out in action. Wisdom is known by her actions, says James. That real faith and real action are tied. They're together. We have to look up. We have to look within. We have to look around. We have to see, as Solomon did, he looks at Jerusalem and those he leads and says, okay, God, I need your help. And I'm going to look around to see ways in which I can lead well as a king. And in our own day and age, looking around to see who we can help as a church and as a family. I've seen so many stories and heard so many stories of people sending cards to one another and encouraging notes and reaching out to people who are really hurting. And I praise God for that reality. And I praise God that he's given us a heart to look around and see how we can help more. I hope we're calling our seniors, those who are shut in and really isolated, those who are just feeling the weight and the burden of this, those who are sick and sending encouraging notes, obviously praying for everybody who's suffering right now. But what ways can we help? What ways can we as individuals or as families or as a church community go and help our larger community? It's a question that we need to be asking, and a question that we need to be wrestling with to make the right decisions to help those around us. It's Psalm 121 that I referred to earlier, that God promises to be the shade at our right hand. We know now that that's someone standing in the city of David, looking up at the temple and holding his hand up and looking up to the temple, because the city of David is lower and the temple is higher, and shielding the sun. Meaning, it's God who provides the sun, it's God who provides the temple and his presence with his people, it's God who provides all. And boy, do we need wisdom right now, wisdom in our own lives to navigate, wisdom to understand what it is that we should be doing. We need to look up, we need to look within, we need to look around. And I praise God that he's given us a heart to pursue him, and tenderized our hearts in this season where we're asking the hard questions of, you know, what is within my heart and how can I ask God to cleanse my heart and to give me a heart that pursues him out of this season. To look up, to see that our help comes from the Lord, our help comes from God, and he will help us in this season. And to look around and say, who is in my influence? Who can I help lead in a way that gives them hope and gives them new life as the gospel has given us all new life? It's the question that Solomon asks. It's the question that you and I are asking. And we know the answer comes from the very God who would show up and be revealed, Jesus, our Lord and Savior, and the Holy Spirit who grants us wisdom for each new decision and all the things that we face. My prayer is that we seek God with all of our heart through this season, that we turn to Him and we lean on Him in this season. We ask the question, am I looking up? Am I looking within and asking God to reveal anything that He wants to cleanse and anything that He wants to put in within us, wisdom to make solid decisions, and to look around and say, okay, how can we make a difference in our life? Join me in a word of prayer, asking God to bless us and keep us. God, we love You and we praise You and we thank You for the story of Solomon's life, who asked the hard questions, not knowing how to navigate. And in our season that we find ourselves in, not knowing really how to navigate, I pray that You would grant us Your wisdom, grant us Your heart, grant us a strong sense of Your presence with us, knowing that You will grant us wisdom, that You promised from Scripture to grant us wisdom, and that we're to ask fully believing that You would grant us wisdom, and that You would bless those who seek Your face. We cling to these promises. It's our hope that You would do that work in our own lives. I thank You for all that You've provided for us, and that You promised to be with us. You promised to give us wisdom to navigate all that life throws at us. We pray for all the health professionals now navigating this, being in the front lines of this epidemic, and we pray for all those struggling with sickness right now from COVID-19, and for our whole church community and beyond our church walls, and all those joining us from other places. God, just bless and keep all of us where we are, in the center of Your will, having us ask the right questions of You, that You would bless and that You would keep, and that we would keep our eyes on You. We love You and we praise You. Everyone said, amen. Now may God bless you, may He keep you, may He make His face shine upon you. As you look to the author of salvation, you look to the one that we all know where our help comes from. Amen. Go in peace. Hi, friends. As we think about Solomon's life and the way he looked around for the ways in which he could use the wisdom of God to influence those around him, we want to ask the same kind of questions. And how can we influence those around us to pursue God and to find the ways of God for their own lives? And I want to point out a few different ways in which you can do that and join us, and think in terms of three different areas. One, beginning in our home. This week we have a unique opportunity on Tuesday night and Thursday night to gather together. If you have kids that you're trying to lead toward God and want to be encouraged along your journey, to join us on a Zoom call at 8:00. Tuesday night would be for the young kids, babies up through elementary school, and then Thursday night would be for the older kids, so junior high and high school, where you can gather as parents, share good ideas, and share ways in which we're trying to point our kids in positive directions, and pray for one another, encourage one another. And so join us those nights. You'll see an email link here to be sent a link to join those calls on Tuesday or Thursday night. And then also thinking about our church family, sort of a wider context, our church family, we're asking everybody to pray and fast on Wednesdays, and then gather together on 7:00 on Zoom, to share testimonies of scriptures that are encouraging us, or ways in which we see God shaping us for His glory through this season. But trying to have a time where we can lift each other up and pray for each other and encourage each other in this season. We've had a great response, and encourage you to join us on Wednesday nights. And if you're watching this video from around the country or world, we want you to join in as well. And so there's a link here you can click, and or an email that we'll send out that link to you on Wednesday morning to join us that night. And then finally, globally, thinking globally, we know the coronavirus is affecting us here locally and regionally, of course, across our country, but globally, in areas especially that don't have refrigeration or the ability to turn on a faucet for water, those areas are going to be far heavier hit by this virus. And so we want to do a clean water project where we're encouraging our folks to do a 6K run walk You can run, you can walk wherever you are from your home or your neighborhood, and that doing so raise money for clean water projects around the world. And so you'll see an email here, Shelley Hill, who's coordinating this, and also a QR code that you could scan with your iPhone and download a registration for that. But we want to be a church that makes a difference, and we want to be a church that, starting in our homes and in our church fellowship and beyond globally, to see that we act in ways that match our faith with our action. Thank you so much, and thanks for joining us today. We pray you have been encouraged and that you will continue to be encouraged and protected and be shown God's favor through this season. Amen. God bless and go in peace.